Hi, everyone. This is an exciting lecture because we are on to chapter 5, which is all about data collection techniques. So in this chapter, Mills goes through a variety of different techniques that you can use to carry out your action research plan. So you've drafted your plan, you've started brainstorming ideas for data collection. So now you can use the ideas in chapter 5 to help you solidify your ideas and make sure that you are on track to collecting enough data to be able to analyze and answer your action research question that you have been crafting in your area of focus. So some of the big ideas in chapter 5 are talking about how you can draw from both qualitative and quantitative data sources to answer your question that is driving your action research project. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that today, as well as some tips for creating the instruments that you will need to collect your data. So one big idea that you do need to know from this chapter is the difference between qualitative and quantitative data. And the chapter does a good job of distinguishing between these types of data and this type of research. So in for our purposes, qualitative research is things that can be analyzed descriptively. So this might be images, it might be words, it might be writing in general, it might be lesson plans, things that you could analyze by describing. And then quantitative is numerical data. And we'll talk about some of those data sources that you can collect. And just a note, quantitative data is different from quantitative research in terms of the methods that you use to, and Mills talks about this, to control variables and to predict the relationship between variables. But qualitative versus quantitative data. And then in this chapter, you learn that it's very common to use a mixed methods approach when you are designing your data collection procedures that you will use. Okay, so starting off with qualitative data collection techniques, the majority of the chapter does talk about qualitative data collection techniques. So it's very likely that you will have at least one of these data collection techniques. And another thing that you'll start to understand through reading the chapter is you most likely will draw from a variety of different data sources to help inform your action research project. So I like this table that Mills used. He used it towards the end of the chapter. I think it would have been more helpful at the beginning, but I'm giving it to you here. So in terms of how to think about organizing your qualitative data techniques when it comes to action research. So the first being experiencing data sources. These are data sources that are collected through observation. And Mills talks about a few different types of observation that you could use, and even giving some helpful suggestions about different purposes for your observation. And so you can think about that. If you are using observation, which of these methods, participant observation, privilege, which is unlikely, or passive observer, would you be using and why? And then think about what is going to guide that observation. Inquiring, this is when the researcher asks. It could be an informal interview, ethnographic interview, a structured formal interview, a focus group, or an open-ended questionnaire. And then examining is when the researcher draws from records. So artifacts, archival documents, journals, either teacher journals, student journals, maps, a sketch of your classroom. I know that a lot of people have mentioned group work. So maybe you have sketches of the different arrangements that you're trying in your classroom, collecting those to compare those with student outcomes, audio recordings, video recordings, other artifacts from student work, or maybe it's, you know, anchor charts, artifacts from your lesson plans, and then field notes that you will use to describe what you are examining. So I was going to make a note. I forgot what it was. Okay. So another important note that kind of goes throughout this entire chapter is to be very mindful about the ethical considerations that come with each data collection technique. So particularly audio recordings, video recordings, think about how you will handle the ethics of that. Now, when you are doing things like questionnaires or artifacts, or even like a student reflection, you can always do what we call as blinding the data, like removing the student name when you are including that data in your final research paper or in data that you share with a critical friend, just to protect their identity. Okay, so this is my attempt to make a bit of a table. So let me walk you through my thinking here. So when you are writing up your action research plan, when you are writing up your action research paper, you are going to talk about your plan for data collection. So you will be using a data collection technique or likely more than one technique. So here are some of the qualitative techniques: observations, interviews, focus groups, an open-ended questionnaire, journal entries or prompts, artifacts. Now, you're not to use all of these. And I'll talk more about this in a moment. But so based on the technique that you're using, with that, there's a corresponding research instrument. So for instance, if you are planning to do an interviews, the instrument that would go with that data collection technique is, or method, is an interview protocol. This is your list of questions that you would do. If you are doing an observation, you might have a record form, a checklist, or something else that you are using. If you're doing a journal, your instrument would be the prompts that are guiding that. So you have your technique, and then below that, you have the corresponding instrument. So this is what you need to prepare before you can collect the data. So if you're hoping to give your students a questionnaire where maybe they do a questionnaire at the end of maybe you're studying in-person science labs. That was a great idea that I saw. And so you want to give students a questionnaire at the end of the lesson so they can reflect and give you feedback on how that felt for them. You would first need to create the questionnaire before you can give it to students. So the instrument is like the tool that you use to collect that type of data. So you have your technique, the corresponding instrument, and then you also have the corresponding data source. So if you're doing observation, the data source that you are going to be analyzing are your field notes. I didn't put this on here, but you know, perhaps you're doing a video recording. If you had the ethical details worked out for that, it might be like a video recording. It might be an audio file. So for your interview, your data source would be the transcripts, the audio files, and so on and so forth. There might be photocopies. So thinking about, okay, what technique are you going to use to collect the data? What instrument do you need to create to collect that type of data? And then after you've collected the data, what will be the data source that results from that? Just to kind of streamline that. So in this, you are reading across. And these go with each other. And so making sure that you're thinking about that proactively on the front end and explaining that in your action research plan and, of course, in your final paper. Okay, so let's get into detail, some of the details Mills gives about the different qualitative techniques. So this is experiencing direct observation. So this is when you want to observe what happens in the classroom as it naturally occurs. So for most of us, we will be taking the active participant observer because we are fully engaged in participating in the classroom activities. We're the ones who have designed the plans, we're the ones implementing the plans, and often we are the ones who are studying the plans when we are engaging in action research in our own classroom. So a privileged active observer would be when you are observing when you're not teaching, like maybe a co-teacher is teaching or a guest speaker or a colleague, and you are observing your students in that way. Perhaps you are observing how they transfer the, like, so for instance, So a lot of you have talked about group work and facilitating group work with students. So sometimes when you are observing, like let's say that you're teaching the students your group roles, you would be taking the active participant observer role because you are participating. Now, let's say that you have assigned the group roles and students are working on those roles. Let's say that you're observing that, you're still an active participant, but then the following week, you go and observe them in maybe a different class. Maybe you are teaching science, you go observe them in their science period to see if those group role lessons have translated to a different setting. So that would be an example of that. And then passive observer, you watch, but you don't participate. So you will see some of the different examples and ways that you can think about this in Mill's chapter. Okay, so I want you to look at this figure and I want you to think, would this be an example of a data collection technique, a research instrument, or a data source? Okay, so this would be an example of a completed data source. Now, if you had this without the names, that would be your research instrument. And the technique that this goes with is observation. So this teacher is going to use this record form to collect their data when they're doing observations. So think about that. If you're including observations, what are the things that you're going to be looking for? Do you want to create some type of template for you? Will you do it virtually, handwritten, and create the template for what you are looking for? Now, this one's very open-ended. Some of the examples in the text and also in Sager's text are much more close-ended. So you can think about what best reflects what you are trying to do with your research purpose. Okay, so experiencing is observation. The data source that results from observation is field notes. So these are the field notes, and you can say they use the record form to collect those field notes. They're written records of what you observed. So when you are focusing in on the observation to observe classroom behaviors, of course, you're listening into conversations, you're focusing on what students are doing or not doing. You need to, as soon as possible, reflect and write down what was observed. And I really liked this little table that Mills included about some different strategies that you can use with your field notes to help you focus even more your observations. Are you trying to observe and record everything, observe and look for nothing, a fresh perspective, or look for like a paradox, an unintended consequence? And there might be many other purposes that you do. You might even observe for a few different purposes. Now, inquiring, asking questions. This is when you would be interviewing probably your students or perhaps a co-teacher, parents, depending on whatever your focus of your action research is. So this is when you are actually asking an intentional question. Instead of just observing things as they naturally occur, this data collection source, you have planned intentionally to ask these questions as part of the research. So like an interview, a questionnaire, open-ended, or a focus group. And Mills talks about some of the different types of interviews, like an ethnographic interview that kind of reminded me of a class discussion, or like an ethnographic focus group that was more in the moment and related to reflection. So there's different types of interviews. It could be semi-structured, where you have, again, your instrument is your interview probe, where you have your list of questions that you can plan out before. Now, it's still okay to ask other questions that don't come up. That's what semi-structured means, is you ask the questions that you planned, and then you listen carefully to whoever you're interviewing, the interviewee, and you interact with what they're saying by asking follow-up questions and letting their responses guide the rest of the interview. So when you are crafting your interview protocol, try to make a balance of open-ended and closed-end questions. The typical recommendation is to start broad and then narrow down. Sometimes you can get students comfortable by asking closed-ended questions and then giving them some open-ended questions once they're feeling comfortable with the process. So again, think about the ethics that you want to employ. Are you going to record it with a transcript? If you are, how are you going to transcribe it? What are you going to do with recordings? How are you going to ensure that students' identities are kept confidential? Now, after interviews, if you are recording and creating a transcript, I hope that you make sure that you don't include student names, including you saying it. I know we've heard podcasts where it's like redacted. A technique that you can do for ethics is once you start the recorder, make sure that you could give that student a number, and you can do a little introduction. Since we have a small amount of data, you probably won't have that many, but don't say the student's name in the recording. And if they say someone's name, you can cross that off in the transcript and delete it or use a pseudonym. Now, after your interviews, you can also, and you should, do field notes, which is your researcher reflection after the interview, what you remember, what you noticed. And if you do an ethnographic interview that kind of happens spur of the moment, you most likely won't have a recorder. I mean, I know we all have our phone, but so you can do a field notes at that time too. Then the examining archival data sources, there's so many, and both of the chapters that we're going to be reading give lots of examples, but you might have other examples as well that would be great data sources that weren't included. So it could be meeting minutes from lesson plans, attendance rates, all of these different ideas, journals, both teacher journals, student journals, reflections, and then all types of different artifacts, maps, photographs, seating charts, videos, student portfolios, student work, anything like that could be a good data source for you. Okay, I think that we pretty much talked about this. When you're thinking about your field notes as a teacher, they could be anecdotal, talking about a specific event that occurred, or it could be reflective. And we talked a lot about that when we were deciding our area of focus. Same thing with journals, narrative reflections over time, student journals to show their progress and their personal experience. Again, trying to get into the habit of doing this as close to the lesson as possible, as close to each day as possible is helpful. Now, quantitative data collection techniques. Depending on your area of focus, you may want to draw on a few quantitative techniques as well. So quantitative techniques are numerical, and they are drawing on data sources that are numbers. And so we have a plethora of these in schools, grades, test scores, percentages, things like that. Now, if you are thinking of using a quantitative data technique, if you find that it's appropriate for your research question, think about the corresponding research instrument that you would need to collect that data. So some examples, of course, you know, teacher-made tests, or this could even be formative data, perhaps like if your students use something like iXL, or if they're using another app like that at the end of each lesson, or whatever you're doing for exit tickets, student work would count for that as well, if it's something that you are assigning a numerical value to. Of course, standardized tests is something that is very common when you are using quantitative data sources. Now, for our purposes, since we're going through the cycle in the course of one semester and your project is due before, more than likely, you will administer MAP testing in the winter, you will likely need to draw on different data sources, but it could be an end of unit assessment. That would be a teacher-made test. If your district does benchmark assessments, it might be more standardized. So there are some options there. Now, some of the others, so of course, you're going to be most familiar with tests or classwork or things of that nature, grades, but there are some other quantitative data collection techniques that you may not have thought of. So we talked about questionnaires, open-ended questionnaire. You can also have a closed-ended survey or a questionnaire that you're able to get data quickly. So this could be something that uses like a Likert scale. This is something you could create in Google Forms. So if you did that, your research instrument would be your survey, where you could go ahead and write that in to do students' Or you could even do like an attitude scale to show how students can share how they felt about a particular lesson. So those are some ideas for quantitative data collection techniques. And if you have other ideas or examples, please drop them in the chat in Perusal. Okay, so when you are thinking about choosing the appropriate data collection techniques, that is the key word. They need to be appropriate. So we've spent all of this work crafting our area of focus and thinking about our research questions, consulting the literature, what is our intervention going to be and why, what is the context where this is happening. So once we start to think about the data collection techniques that we are going to choose first, we are going to think about the concept that we refer to as triangulation. So triangulation is a technique that you can use to strengthen the quality of your research and bolster the reliability of your findings. And we're going to do the whole next chapter is all about reliability and validity, but a primary concept that you need to think about at this stage is triangulation. So this concept is, if you think of a triangle, you have 3 points. That's extremely traditional. You can have more than three, but the concept is still very useful. Using multiple data sources to validate your findings. So the philosophy about how we can determine what's true is that one data source might show us one aspect of an issue, but if we are able to shine light on that issue through multiple different vantage points, through multiple different data sources, we get a clearer picture of what's happening. And this is something as teachers that we are in great practice of doing all the time. So we oftentimes, when we have student test scores, quantitative data, we like to contextualize that with perhaps their portfolio, with their oral response, to get a clear picture of what that student knows. This is one of the techniques that you can use to prevent bias. So if you only used your teacher journal and did not triangulate that with perhaps student formative data scores, you might have one perception and then other data sources show a different picture. So that's a way for you to prevent bias in your work, to kind of cross verify the data, or if they don't necessarily agree, that's still a finding to talk about why those divergences exist. So for example, you might draw from observations, surveys, interviews, and a few artifacts. And you might consider mixing both qualitative and quantitative. Do you remember what that's called? Mixed design. So that's something to think about too when you're describing your approach to data collection, which of your sources are qualitative, which are quantitative, and if you're using both, is it mixed design and why? So I suggest one of these triangulation matrices. I know that over the past several chapters, we've been talking about visuals. So visuals are more than appropriate and encouraged in your action research plan and in your paper. These concept maps can go in multiple different parts of your project. So a triangulation matrix is a great thing to do when you start to think about the data collection sources that would be great to answer your research questions. So when you do this strategy, you write down your research question, and then you start to think about the different data sources that you could use to get some information about that question. And so here you can see they have their questions and then their data sources. Now, you might just have one question, you might have two questions, but you can map on the data sources here to start thinking about why and how will this data source answer or address the research question. So try this out and see how that goes. This is at the end of chapter 5, but it is so important. It's not that much text, but I do want to emphasize this. So during the data collection phase, it's important that you engage in the reflection and adjustment process. So just how teachers are always making adjustments in real time. Action researchers are following the same philosophy, being very responsive, reflective, and adjusting as needed based on the data that they are collecting. So sometimes and oftentimes when you are engaging in action research, you're constantly going back and realigning your research. It's so important that your area of focus aligns with your research questions. Okay, your area of focus aligns with the interventions you've selected, which aligns with your research questions, which aligns with the data collection technique that you are using. Those are all aligned and connected, and one informs the other. So you constantly need to be reflecting and making sure that you have that alignment. And when your study shows some disalignment, readjusting to realign. And when this happens, journal about it, write about it. What happened? Why did you realign? And what is your next step? So when you start collecting, just to emphasize, make sure that your research focus or your data collection methods are fully addressing your research question. And if they're not, you'll need to do an adjustment. So once you start collecting data, start reflecting on it right away and make sure that the data you're collecting aligns with your research question. And so if it doesn't, you may need to collect some different data. Or if it's close, you might need to rephrase your research question to reflect the data that you are collecting. And then think about, is the data revealing the insights that you hope for, or is it raising a new question in which you might consider writing a research question that reflects that new question and then using that data to answer that. So you might adjust for the purpose there, but then also you might need to adjust and make some changes based on the methods or techniques that you chose. If your data is insufficient, you could think about how you could modify or augment or supplement your data collection techniques. Or if your data is suggesting a new direction, you could adapt that research to find new variables, perhaps a new intervention that you could use that would be more successful in addressing the problem that you have found. And we will get into this in the coming weeks as well, but you are constantly engaging in the reflection and action cycle, even in this stage when you're collecting data. So here is an example. So let's say that the study, as so many examples have, focused on student engagement. The researcher might shift to teacher strategies if the observations show that the student engagement is actually mostly impacted by the strategy that the teacher uses. And so then the teacher quickly realizes, okay, the research issue is not so much how do I keep students engaged? It's more so which strategies am I using that are more engaging? And so that's a slight shift. So being flexible, open to evolving research questions, going back and revising your research questions as your data emerges, and understanding that action research and research in general is an iterative process. And so adjustments are part of doing great research and deepening the inquiry. Okay, so I also wanted to leave you with a few nuggets from Sager. So I included those in Perusal, Sager Chapter 7 and Sager Chapter 8. As usual, he has some great visuals, tables that you can use. So I recommend scanning these chapters. So teacher records, of course, lesson plans, grade books, attendance records, even like creating like a timeline of your intervention, what that looks like, trend analysis, what you are noticing. I put these implementation strategies if you want to refer to the pages in his text to see those. And then he has a lot of great examples about the instruments that you might use to carry out observations. So open-ended checklists, predefined checklists, time on task checklists, and then ideas for student journals to think about that. So here are just a few of the visuals that he included. So this is an example of the timeline. So you can see that is a data source here. This is an open-ended checklist where they are counting the frequency of occurrences that happened in the classroom. And this is a rubric, which would be like a rating scale for student work. So if you are using student portfolios or assignments, you could consider using a rating scale like this. And then chapter 8 is all about creating instruments to answer your research questions. And so he gave lots of prompts for reflective prompts for teachers, reflective prompts for students. For instance, for students, you might have them reflect, what did you find most useful in today's lesson? What would you do differently next time? Or for teachers too. Like teacher logs, notes, comments, lots of great suggestions and visuals. Sager also gives two guidelines for developing a survey, a little checklist here to create your survey, and then also for interview guidelines when you are developing your interview protocol. So those are in the perusal if you are interested in those. So I know that this was long, hopefully it's helpful, but as far as choosing the right data collection technique, it needs to align with your research focus. Think about what types of data will help you answer those. Then think about, okay, is that qualitative, quantitative, or mixed? And again, starting with your research question and then going from there, try that matrix to help you too. Okay, so make sure that you know the difference between qualitative and quantitative, and you can give examples for each. You understand what triangulation means and that you have multiple data sources that can inform or offer insight, and that you have a balanced approach. So I'm looking forward to hearing your ideas for data collection and seeing your ideas as it relates to Chapter 5.